Okay, good morning, beautiful beings. Nice to have you back, and welcome to anyone who might be joining us for the first time. I got a couple of messages over the last 12 hours or so from folks who are still making their way onto the retreat. So yeah, we're still having a few folks still joining us over the next couple of days. So yeah, we just really want to encourage you to do everything you need to take care of yourself in this session. I am so grateful to everyone who was able to contribute last night in our closing intention setting ritual. And I have now put those on the Padlet. So if you weren't able to join us, there's a link to the mantra that we listened to. So we listened to the Shakyamuni mantra from Mahasukha's beautiful album, Longing. So that's there, and all of the intentions that were offered are there under the link. So have a look. And thanks to all those of you who've also been contributing to the Padlet. So there's some poems and some personal sharings on there. So do have a look. I believe our illustrious Zoom host for today, for one morning or one early session and one early session only, we've got Upeksha Priya with us today. So thanks for being with us, Upeksha Priya. So if you wouldn't mind putting the link to the Padlet in the chat, that would be great so people can have a look. So the plan for today, just bear with me while I share my screen just to go over what we're doing today. in this session, rather. So we're here in the welcome. In a moment, I'll be leading us in an arriving practice. I thought it might be nice to do some Qigong movements. And yeah, do feel free to make any modifications for your own body with these movements. So it's fine to stay seated if you'd rather. I'm going to stand up and there's an invitation too, but you can stay seated if that's more comfortable for you. And then I'll guide us in a mettā bhavana practice. And I'll say a few things before then, just a few reflections on how to link what we've been doing to our practice of the mettā bhavana, the cultivation of loving kindness. And we'll have a 15-minute break and we'll come back and Balajit will lead us in an exploration around the question, what is the body in direct experience? Carrying on from what we were exploring yesterday. Okay, so I'm gonna come back to you, stop sharing. And just bear with me while I get myself set up here in a standing posture, and do take your time to get yourself set up in a comfortable standing posture as well. We'll just be doing these movements for about 10 minutes. Okay, so I just want to check that you can all hear me okay if I speak at this volume. Is that all right? Yeah, great. Thanks for the thumbs up. And if you are having trouble, actually, it's worth saying if you're having any problems with tech, do private message Upeksha Priya and he'll try and help you out. So we'll just take a moment to arrive in this posture, standing or maybe you're sitting. So just arriving. Feeling the connection with the ground under the feet or the sitting bones if you're sitting. And just noticing how the weight of the body naturally wants to drop down into the feet, into the ground. So feeling that pressure and any other sensations there. And this just checking that you've got soft knees, so having the knees slightly bent. Feeling the uprightness of the body rising out of the lower body. So the upper body rising up, feeling the sense of the crown pointing towards the sky. And just bringing an intention of softness here. So soft pelvis, soft belly, soft heart, soft throat, soft crown. And maybe just taking a few deep breaths if that feels good. Making any sounds that feel good to you on the out breath. And then just letting the breath return to its natural rhythm. And then on an in-breath, we're just going to very gently raise the arms to about shoulder height. And then on the out-breath, let them drop down. Just letting the breath lead the movement here. And we'll just do this 4 times. And then on the next in-breath, raising the hands to the heart and then turning them outward and pushing away. And then turning them back inward and pulling towards. And then dropping them back down. So breathing in, hands to the heart, breathing out, pushing away, breathing in, pulling towards, breathing out, dropping down. And as we do these movements, just noticing what's happening energetically in the body. And the next in-breath up to the heart, and this time we're going to throw the arms wide open. Like we're giving the whole world a hug. And then coming back to the heart and dropping down. Noticing any shifts in the emotional body as well. Letting the movement support it, dropping down into what's here. Next movement, we're going to take the arms all the way up. You can let the eyes follow. And then out and down. Four movements of that last one. We're just going to rest for a moment and standing. Another thing that these very simple movements can reveal to us is places of softness as well as stuckness or contraction in the body. So places where we might feel a bit more open, expansive, warm, and also places that might feel a bit more numb, stuck, contracted. And in this practice, we're just noticing that. So we're not trying to fix anything. Just letting it be as it is. It's practicing to let it be. So now we're going to stitch it all together. So we'll do 4 rounds of one movement after the other. And if you don't know what I mean by that, it's fine because you can just follow me. Okay, so Just taking one breath here before beginning. And then on the next in-breath, lifting the arms. Hands to heart. And pushing away. Pulling towards and dropping down. Hands to heart. Arms wide open. Coming back in and dropping down. And then all the way up to the sky. Out wide and down. So for these next three rounds, just following your own pace, the rhythm of your own breath. Just rest here and standing for a couple of breaths, just noticing, particularly noticing if there's been any shifts in energy, sensations, mood, emotions, sense of presence. And then taking your time to make your way back to your seat and just doing any movement, stretches, rubbing, self-touch that feels good to you as you make this transition. So I'm going to guide us in a metta bhavana practice. So I was just going to say a few words before we get into the practice. So I was remembering, probably because she's with us on this retreat, although she's probably in deep sleep at the moment. I hope she's having good dreams. Our friend Viveka, who taught me the metta bhavana over 20 years ago now. And let's just say I was a hot mess when I first rocked up to the San Francisco Buddhist Center. And I had absolutely no idea what Viveka was talking about. So she was, you know, inviting us to bring an attitude of friendliness and loving kindness to ourselves. And as soon as I sort of tried to do that, I became aware of how contracted and tight and cold and hard my heart was. And after the class, I went up to her in my usual overdramatic way. And I was like, oh, I couldn't, I can't do it. I can't send metta to myself. I'm a horribly flawed person. You know, lots of catastrophizing about the fact that I felt that I had failed at the practice. And she just sort of looked at me in a very loving way and just said, wow, that's really interesting. And she just sort of held the tension, you know, while I took that in. It was very surprising. It wasn't what I expected. And it was only on reflection sort of years later that I realized that what I had wanted was for her to collude with me. And she just wasn't going to do that. So it was like she just held up a mirror and invited me to just get curious about my experience. So if that's what I met in this invitation to bring loving kindness to myself, could I get curious about that? Could I, you know, following on from the teachings from yesterday, could I learn to tend to what was there, you know, and really let it be as it was, and then over time learn to turn towards it and engage more deeply with it. So I know from, you know, doing a lot of teaching over the years that this is a common experience for many of us. We can find it hard to bring metta to ourselves for lots of different reasons. Or it may be that it's easier for us to bring metta to ourselves, but maybe not others. Or maybe it's easier for us to bring metta to others, but not ourselves. So we'll all have different edges around the practice. But I want to suggest that maybe the way that we could enter the practice today is to really use it as an opportunity to just trust in our innate goodness. You know, trust that metta is our fundamental true nature. And that rather than thinking that we're cultivating anything, although that can be helpful as well. So we know that antidotes are a helpful strategy, as we explored yesterday. And what might it be like to also just see all the things, all the resourcing that we're doing, you know, the self-touch, the orienting, the grounding, the tender breath. And we'll be doing more around resourcing later in the retreat as well, unpacking that a bit more. But all the things we do to tend to the experience are ways that we're sort of gently encouraging that innateness to shine through the veils, the cloudiness of the obscurations, the afflicted mental states, the poisons. So we don't have to try and make anything happen. We can just trust in the process of taking deep care of ourselves and meeting ourselves where we are just now. And then in that process, slowly learning how to let it be as it is, and then, which has, you know, it has an element of acceptance, although I know for me that word was problematic for a long time. So maybe it's just an acknowledgement in the beginning, and then we edge into acceptance. And then eventually, turning towards and engaging and seeing what might become possible in that turning towards that wasn't possible before. And the last thing I'll say is maybe part of how we could see this way of working as And I think this is helpful for those of us who might be highly idealistic, which I definitely fall into that camp. You know, we want to feel unconditional loving kindness towards ourselves and others, don't we? We deeply, deeply want that. And we know we want that. And yet, so often, that is not how I feel. And how can I hold the tension between the ideal and what's happening now? And the invitation is to maybe try on these three ways of being with emotion that we explored yesterday as a potential answer to that question of how we can hold the tension. Okay, so that's enough words. Let's get going with the practice. So finding a comfortable posture, lying down, sitting, standing. Maybe taking a few deep breaths here, if that feels good to you. As a way to help the body to settle, finding the ground. With each out breath, really inviting the body to surrender to the support of the earth. And also, as we surrender to the support of the earth, noticing how the whole of the upper body rises up towards the sky with the in-breath. Just noticing how the body naturally wants to expand into space. So the metta bhavana practice, cultivation of loving kindness. So in this first stage, just inviting you to spend a few minutes noticing how you are. Attending to our experience as an act of friendliness towards ourselves. Making space for what's here. And as we do this, we'll inevitably come across a whole range of experiences, some pleasant, some unpleasant, some neutral. So there's an invitation to work with tending to all of these experiences in whatever way you know works for you. And here you might also find it helpful to remember your intention. And that part of you that wants to be well and happy. I'm just noticing the effect this has. So the bell is just a gentle sign of something shifting, but we don't have to change anything in our experience. Just introducing another person into the practice. So bringing to mind a good friend. And just noticing what happens when you do that, how the body responds. Maybe even letting yourself be surprised by any emotions you didn't expect, whatever they might be. And then in your own way, just connecting with your friend's own deep desire to be happy and well. Noticing the effect this has on you and tending to and letting be whatever arises in response to that reflection on their own deep desire for wellness. And if you are in touch with feelings of warmth, expansion, friendliness, softness towards the friend, the invitation is to really turn towards and dwell in those sensations, really letting them fill you up, even enjoying them. And then if there's anything else going on, maybe a subtle jealousy or a remembering of something we need to say to them that might be a bit difficult, or anything that's showing up in the body as stuckness, contraction, coldness, hardness. Just also tending to that, welcoming that as it is. Taking care of yourself. So again, just gently transitioning now to someone we don't know that well, a neutral person. Here we might engage the imagination a bit just to really build a picture of them in the mind. The places we encounter them, the way they usually show up in those places. The way we show up in those places. And again, just giving space to what's arising, simply as we bring this person to mind and heart. And noticing what resonates when we remember that they also have an inherent need for safety, dignity, belonging, to be well, to be happy, to be free from suffering. Noticing how the body responds to these reflections that's moving through you. So feel free to do a bit of resourcing, deep breaths, self-touch. You could open the eyes, look around a bit, feel the ground beneath you, anything that supports presence. And then in your own time and in your own way, bringing to mind someone you're having difficulty with. And in the spirit of getting real, maybe there's even a part of you that doesn't really like this person very much. Just noticing what it's like to both bring this person in imaginatively and recognize what comes up for us in response to their presence in our internal landscape. And maybe it's enough just to tend to whatever's here as best we can. Maybe it's possible to give it all some space, let it be as it is, without getting drawn into the narratives. And as we do this, we can also remind ourselves that this person, even when they're being really irritating, and we just want to put them in a box and off to the side, they too just want to be happy and well. They also just need safety and belonging, even if we think their strategies for getting it are flawed. How can we make space for them to be just as they are? And here you might notice contraction somewhere in the body, which is a normal response. So tending to anything that's difficult to be with just now. And letting it also be as it is. So taking a moment to reconnect with ourselves, our own sense of what we need just now. Our good friend, the neutral person, the person we find difficult, all together in the imagination. Noticing what comes up as we do that, and then in your own time, beginning to broaden the circle. You could start with everyone on the retreat. Appreciating our intentions and our wish for wellness. Extending to loved ones, friends, family, colleagues, fellow Sangha members. And then expanding even beyond the people we know to the whole of humanity and all living beings. And even beyond living beings, just the whole of the universe, everything that appears magically. And that we share and are intimately connected with. May all be well. So for the last minute or so of this loving kindness practice, I invite you to just let go of any effort you might be making. Feel free to open the eyes, let in light and color. You could put the hands palm up in the lap. Maybe taking a few deeper breaths here and just opening. You could even imagine like all the pores of the skin totally open and receptive. So just sitting in a warm, open space of awareness. Everything as it is. And absorbing the fruits of the practice.
Nice to see you all popping back onto my screen. Yeah, so hello everybody. And yeah, thank you Singhashri for that. I felt like I was being enticed into the, beautifully enticed into the warm open space of awareness. Just the tone of your voice and the languaging. Yeah, thank you. It was like a kind of beautiful wind. Drawing me to a more expansive place. So yeah, thank you for that. So we'll carry on. I'm going to give just a little bit of input, and then we'll practice together the mindfulness of breathing. I just want to tell a little bit of a story. It's a story. I don't know if you find this, but sometimes an image or a story kind of keeps coming back, you know, from sometimes the image just pops up, or sometimes it might be, you know, an event that happened previously in your life. And there's a story that, experience I had when I was very young. I don't know how old I was, but I don't know, about 6 or 7. And just in the last year or two, it just kept coming back to me. It was something that happened in the middle of the night. And it's like, it seems now related a bit to my Buddhist practice. And I was just thinking about, you know, the Buddha talked about at some point in his going forth that he had an image from childhood, a memory from childhood came of sitting under a rose apple tree, you know, and there was something about the experience he had there, meditative absorption, that seemed to have some significance for how he kind of took his life forward and things. So it was dark, and I woke up in the middle of the night, and I had quite a lot of fear. And I think that happened to me every so often. So I had this little torch by my bed, you know, that I could reach out to in the dark, and then just light up my little room, you know. And I was quite an obsessive football fan, and my room was covered with all these images of football players and such. It was pasted all over my room and things, all these images. But so I turned the torch on, and then I was lying in my bed, and then I looked up and I saw this black, dark spider. Yeah, and it was about 10 or 11 inches in length. It was absolutely huge, you know. And I remember just being there and just literally kind of freezing. You know, I didn't know what to do. You know, I was freezing in fear, really. And it was moving. It was like creeping really small. And it was directly above my head, you know. And I was in this kind of frozen position for kind of like some time. And then suddenly some kind of shift happened for me. And I came out of that kind of frozen immobility. And I just looked down at the torch, and I saw this like absolutely kind of like minuscule little spider on the top of the on the top of the torch lens, yeah, that was being projected, you know. And in that moment, you know, I had this big shift. Obviously, you know, I would do as a little kid. I was in fear anyway when I woke up. And my interpretation changed, and suddenly it was just me with the torch of this kind of rather cute little tiny little spider creeping across. And I think part of the reason this memory keeps coming back is there's something around how the way the mind can project stories onto our experience that we can then take as real, and then we have very, very real bodily responses to them as if it's really happening, you know. And obviously that has quite a lot of parallels with, you know, what the Buddha's trying to help us to see, you know, in a sense is how we're creating a lot of suffering for ourselves through not seeing how things really are. You know, through not seeing how things really are. This Vasantra, who's many of you will know, who's a teacher in our tradition and order, he says, we're storytelling animals. The problem is we don't see that's what we're doing. You know, we're storytelling animals. The problem is we don't see that that's what we're doing. So I wonder, you know, to what extent are we conditioned into believing stories about the very nature of our experience, you know, the nature of ourselves, our body, other people, and to what extent might that projection that, you know, we've inherited from our culture and our language, to what extent that kind of tendencies of the mind, the interpretations that we make, may be kind of limiting us, you know. Sangharakshita, this is another one of my favorite quotes at the moment. So this is Sangharakshita. He says, the ego is not a thing, but a faulty interpretation. One is seeing something that just isn't there. It never was and it never will be. And because it isn't there, one can't do anything with it. Get rid of it, go beyond it, or whatever. If the ego is shown to be an illusion, one's fears on its behalf are extinguished. You see that there is no one to lose anything, and so you have nothing to lose. You see that there is no one to lose anything, so you have nothing to lose. So again, this partly leads me to this, I mean, the potential here in a way, because we often think about, you know, how can I try to awaken? But for me, this gives a bit of a different perspective, is that how can we learn to stop unawakening ourselves in a way? You know, we have habits and tendencies that are actively unawakening us. You know, we're actively through habit eclipsing ourselves to the, you know, luminous qualities of compassion, awareness, spaciousness, to the qualities of the bodhisattvas. You know, can we start to see what we are doing, what we are believing in, that is closing us off to the awakened heart? You know, there's all different sorts of languaging around that. It's this, isn't it? You know, we've got I've got these kind of, you know, glasses of suffering, second hour unnecessary suffering on. So can I start to see this kind of for what it's doing? You know, it's like, what's it like when I've got them on? Hold a minute. And what's it like when I take it off? You know, does ease, expansiveness, compassion, connection, energy, tranquility, equanimity, is there a movement towards that with the glasses off? And is there a more constricted, limited mode of being with that? And we really have the ability to see this in the mindfulness of breathing. You know, if there's a warm, open, if our experience is arising more in a warm, open space of awareness, what's that like? And what is it like when I start to contract into wanting what isn't present, the greed poison? And what's it like when I start to contract and resist what is present, the hatred element? And what's it like when I'm just ignoring experience, foggy, cloudy, and so on? So I think there's an important point here, and it took me quite a long while to discover this, and it's an ongoing process of deepening it into it, is that, so I'll just talk in terms of the mindfulness of breathing here, is that I don't need, fortunately, I don't need to kind of stop thinking, you know, I don't need to stop images coming up, whether they're deluded or not, whether they lead to suffering or not. But for me, there's something around it's seeing that they're thinking. You know, clearly discerning that it's thinking, clearly discerning that it's an image. Yeah. Because if I don't see that, then I kind of become that perspective. Whereas if there's more discerning awareness, it can just be seen as a thought. You know, it can just be seen as a thought, and it doesn't kind of lead to all that bodily contraction. It's not made real. We don't make it real. We just see it's a fleeting little result of past karma, you know, the momentum of thinking that way and believing that way in the past. And it seems that if we can see a thought as a thought and an image as a thought clearly, then they can come up and it, like a horse in a field that's no longer tethered, eventually, because it's not being refueled by being taken as real, it loses its power. You know, this is one of my favorite things at the moment. So this is a Hoberman sphere, so quite a clever little device. So we've got the breath, haven't we? You know, and in the mindfulness of breathing, we're encouraged to bring awareness to the breath and to know a short breath as a short breath and a longer breath as a longer breath and everything in between. And as Singhashri was saying yesterday, it can be a very good barometer, the breath. You know, if it's really, really shallow, it's possibly a sign that we're like moving more towards quite a deep state of absorption, particularly if it's slow. And sometimes if it's shallow, it can be a sign that we're kind of getting a little bit overwhelmed and our system's starting to shut down. So there's a lot in the breath. So what is the breath in direct experience? You know, what is it? So we can project that we know what the breath is. It's like something of air that comes into our lungs and out of our lungs. There's a conventional way of seeing it. But what if we let go of all those, every understanding we've got, and just allow ourselves to drop into the body in and of itself? We clearly see thoughts as thoughts, not body, and we clearly see images as images. And then we just open into this visceral, energetic, emotional mystery. And the openness is partly from not knowing, you know, just being with the not knowing. So I'm always going on talking longer than I think. I keep thinking I haven't got much to say. So let's have a sit and let's do the mindfulness of breathing. And if I can just do a little sound check, so just check you can hear the bell. So we have a 35-minute period of practice here. So as Vivekananda was saying last night, there's huge depths to mindfulness, from just being aware of the breath to deeply engaging with its impermanence, its insubstantiality. Breath as mystery. Maybe just getting a broad sense here of our posture and our support. Is it possible to allow ourselves the space to just be here fully as we are? collection of habits and this extraordinary potential to awaken. So the body is always by nature sensitive. The invitation here is to open to that sensitivity. Open to the feeling life of our being. And as we start here, I'd just like us to do a little exercise. So I'm inviting you to become aware of either your left or right hand. And seeing if you can open to a felt sense of your hand. And as you dwell on the felt sense of your hand, seeing if you can discern between the actual sensations of the hand, how it feels in the body, and any thoughts or images of the hand that may be projected onto it. So this is mindfulness of a hand. We'll spend a minute or so on this. What's going on? Can you feel the edges to their hand and its fingers? Can you feel edges? Where the finger stops and the space around it begins? What's actually happening in the hand? In and of itself. And then from here, the invitation is now to become sensitive to your whole body. If the mind is quite intoxicated with thinking, you might benefit from some calming. You might like to just feel your body and feel the ground equally. Allowing the body to be as it is in awareness and feeling its relationship with the stillness of the ground. So sensitive to the whole body. It's very easy to not want to fight an aspect of experience, pushing away. So just noticing if that's there. And to be longing or wanting what isn't present. Craving. So rather than try and control their arising, can we get more clarity about what's happening as our experience changes? And then within this cloud of sensations, are the changing patterns of sensations we associate with what we call breathing. So my invitation here is just to gently allow yourself to rest, or allow the breath to come into more focused awareness as you're sensitive with a broader awareness too. And sometimes here it can feel like you're upstairs, you're in your head and you're looking down on the breath. So that's an example of being merged with a story, a concept. So just noticing if that's present and has power. Feeling the changing sensations of breathing. So in a spirit of openness to the fullness of the body experience, so the breath can be percolated by emotion, and emotion can percolate the breath. So these different dimensions of the body, the energetic, the emotional, all having their space. You may wish to apply counting if you feel that can give you a helpful handrail. Breath is mystery. You're feeling the breath in the context of a body with feeling. sometimes thoughts and images pass through and like fireworks, there and gone. Sometimes they're like kind of spilt ink. They kind of stain the mind and have a hold. So just noticing that. And if you're finding that focusing on the body directly like this is leading to more disconnection, whether into anxiety or feeling spacey, maybe opening the eyes and looking around, focusing on sound, creating some distance for a while at least. Mindfulness of breathing. And if there's a sense of spaciousness here, there's a sense of spaciousness here. Is there an eye that's aware of the breath? Or is the spaciousness innately aware? And if there's a sense of a separate observer looking on here, the lifeguard, is the observer anything other than a thought that's believed? An interpretation. Where is the observer in direct experience? Is it possible to rest into not knowing? Mystery. Even wonder. And left alone in the open space of awareness. Experiences self-arise and self-subside. Aim our whole. So in a minute, I'll ring the gong to mark the end of this period of practice. And we'll come together again in 4 hours. And feel free to make any physical gestures, sound gestures, chat gestures as we say goodbye. Go well. Lots of fingers.